Welcome to another edition of Dead Air Live. Tonight, I'd like to introduce you to Bill Burrell, who has put together this wonderful, wonderful show about Yellowstone National Park. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you, JoJo. Do you want to be Joanne, JoJo? What would you like to be today?
I'm everything, but tonight I'm JoJo.
All right, because I got to tell everybody at home, I am the studio manager here at Somerville Community Access Television.
Yes, you are.
And it's very weird for me to be on this side of the camera.
Yes, it is. But Bill, you have some great news. Before we get into the Yellowstone, you have exciting breakthrough news for everyone.
Breaking news.
Just so
like Channel
7,
the news station, yes. For those of you people here that are volunteers here, that are maybe want to be volunteers here, especially you folks here with SPG Dead Air Live, you will all be glad to know, especially those of you running camera one, our camera that's getting a little creaky.
Right.
As of 3 weeks from today, we will have three, not one, not two, but three brand new high-definition studio cameras right here in the studio.
Oh, I'm so excited.
Marvelous. I mean, many thousands of dollars, all to put out better productions right here on Channel 3 Somerville Community Access Television.
And this is great news, and we're one of the first access stations
in the country.
In the country?
In the country.
Did you hear that?
In the country. Because we rule.
We do.
We're not number one 3 years in a row for nothing.
All right.
Yeah.
So, Bill, let's talk about Yellowstone. You directed, edited, did the videography.
Yep.
What else am I missing?
Voiced over.
You didn't do the music. You got the music.
Did a lot of driving.
You did a lot of driving. So, why Yellowstone?
Why? I'm glad you asked me that, actually. Different people do different things as a break from reality. Okay, some people go to Miami on vacation and sit on the beach with a drink in their hands. Some people go to spiritual retreats. Some people go climbing mountains or walking the seashore. My wife, Suzanne, who is a photographer, and myself, the video guy, needed somewhere that we could do something together. And many years ago, we discovered the West per se, and then Yellowstone specifically. Yellowstone was the first national park. It is the largest national park aside from Denali up in Alaska, which is a hard, that's a long drive. As it is, we drive out there now, but we view it as an escape. It's a retreat. It's a place to go to get away from the everyday. It's beautiful scenery in every direction. There's not a place there you cannot take a good picture or a good video. All kinds of good stuff that is well worth going to, but more importantly, it's a break from reality. When we go there, there's no cell phones, there's no human beings.
You don't take your cell phone.
I take it, I turn it off, throw it in the car, and pick it up 3 weeks later.
So you drive from Boston out to Yellowstone. A lot of people, they don't know that Yellowstone covers Montana, Idaho, and Wyoming.
Yep, mostly in Wyoming, but because Back when Yellowstone was first formed, the three states had a fight over where it was going to be, and basically they ended up putting it in all three states just to make them all happy, but it's mainly in Wyoming.
Well, you have these incredible images that are playing behind us.
Right.
So when you drive out there, do you get out of the car and trek through the woods, or do you stop off at places that normal tourists will go?
Well, we're going to talk more about that during our next break, but right now let's take a look at one of the first tunes we've got for you.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
Bill, tell us about the weather. It looks beautiful.
It is. It's a whole different ecosystem up there, and that's the same way that they refer to it. If you talk to the park rangers or any of the regulars, the Yellowstoneys, so to speak, the park ranges from about 2,500 feet to about 10,000 feet in elevation, and they're about 3 weeks behind our weather. So we traditionally go out there. We're spring Yellowstone people. We're there after the last snowfall goes out and the park opens up for the summer. We like it because the baby animals are all born in April and May, and when you go there, you get to see a lot of the newborns, so to speak. And as you'll see in the first couple of pictures that we have here, my wife is the photographer, and she loves the spring flowers. And maybe we can get a couple of the spring flowers now. And as they can just kind of roll through them as they'd like to and put them on the air.
Sure.
The colors are amazing. Again, there's not a place you can go up there without seeing a flower. There isn't even an ant on that flower, for those of you paying close attention.
Are they usually ants on the flowers?
Well, there's bugs everywhere. If you're not a bug person, it's not a great place to go.
There were a lot of bugs, so you have to wear a lot of insect repellent.
You do. As you'll see in the next picture, which is really cool, it's a purple flower. It's an aster. We've got a huge yellow inside. They're just wildflowers. There's nothing planted. It's not a park like you would see park here in Somerville. I mean, it's not kept by anybody.
Okay.
You just show up and go, oh my goodness, look at this, This year, for instance, they're not going to open the East Gate to Yellowstone, which is in Wyoming, until May 31st, until Memorial Day weekend, because during the month of March alone, they had 101 inches of snow in Yellowstone. They're breaking snowplows trying to keep the roads clear enough to get the park people in and out. There's not even any tourists allowed in the park at this point, but just trying to keep the main ranger stations open and whatnot. They've broken two of the over 100-year-old huge heavy-duty plows just trying to keep it open. By the time we get there, usually the middle of June, somewhere around there, the nights still drop down to 30 degrees. During the day, it gets up to 60 to 65. The only month of the year that it does not snow is July.
Really?
I mean, it's kind of interesting weather. The first day we were there last time, it was snowing to beat the band. In the middle of the snowstorm, we stopped by the side of the road, and a bunch of people were looking into the woods, so we got out to see what it was. We'd only been there 2 minutes, and there was a huge grizzly bear eating the berries with the snow just coming down like mad. Quite the welcome. When you know you're at Yellowstone when you see that. You don't see too many grizzly bears around here.
Do you camp when you go out there?
We cabin. We don't camp per se.
We
cabin.
You have to reserve a cabin, of course.
A year in advance.
A year in
advance. Yeah, because there's not that many. Despite the fact that Yellowstone is a huge tourist attraction, there aren't that many people that are insane, like my wife and I, who want to be at the park by 5:30 in the morning and don't leave it until damn near dark at 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. And the cabin space is scarce. You have Jackson, Wyoming, about an hour and a half south of the park, and you've got West Yellowstone, Montana, just outside the park's west entrance. But they're small towns. I mean, compared to around here, you're talking teensy tiny. And he's saying we've got about 30 seconds for the next piece.
Okay, thank you.
Hear it out of the back of my ear.
Okay.
It's a small area. I mean, if it wasn't for the park, there would be absolutely nothing there, which is okay, because there's not supposed to be anything.
Are there any amenities in the cabin? Or?
No.
So you have to use an outhouse.
That's a beautiful purple flower, by the way. Okay, let's take another break right now for a second and watch the next video coming up. This is just good stuff. We'll talk more about my wife's flower videos when we come back.
They're beautiful. Thank you. Bill, this footage is amazing.
You like the eagle? I like the eagle.
I love the eagle. There's so many beautiful animals there. But
you asked me while we were watching.
Yes.
Can you film all this from the side of the road, so to speak?
I did. Okay? I did.
I don't want to discourage anyone from going to Yellowstone. I am a Yellowstone freak. My wife is a Yellowstone freak. Okay.
Yeah.
We keep returning. We drive the 2,000 miles to get there because we have a truck full of gear to bring. I mean, we're insane. You can fly right in there to Jackson Hole through a combination, through Delta, through Denver, or through Salt Lake.
Like this beautiful
camera. But in answer to your question, anybody that wants to go to Yellowstone can see stuff they've never seen before in their entire life by simply following the tourist routes. Yes, we have gone off the tourist routes for some of the stuff that we've done, but a good chunk of the video that you're seeing here, and that it was in my television production as well, is from the touristy areas. Now, that's one of the reasons we get there so early in the year. When you get there the beginning of the season, from about the end of May to the end of June, the kids aren't entirely out of school yet. The tourists aren't entirely there yet, so the animals aren't quite as timid. They're not staying away from the people, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
So when you go out at 5:30 in the morning, the buffalo will walk right up to your car and look in your window.
Are they dangerous, the buffalo?
Well, they can be. I mean, there are cute signs all over the place like, please don't ride the buffalo, because, I mean, there's always idiot tourists out there yelling, here, buffalo, buffalo, buffalo. I mean, it's not a real good idea.
Do you feed the animals?
The animals ever. Back in the early 1900s, they used to feed the bears, among other things, the scraps from the hotels that are in Yellowstone, owned by the National Park.
Seems dangerous.
It was not a very good idea, because then they suddenly decided to not do that, and the bears got ornery. And that's where the Yogi Bear Jellystone Park thought came from, where the cartoon came from, because at that point they started stealing human food because they couldn't find any human garbage to eat. And it took 40 years to get them out of the habit of wanting to eat human food. And now it's a decided no-no. Now I'm going to give you my bear story.
Oh, you have your bear story.
And I'm not sure this video is next, so we'll worry about that part next. But my wife is a photographer. She was... As a matter of fact, if Jeannie can find it, our graphics lady, Jeannie, does have a picture of a thistle. I don't remember what number it is, but it's a thistle. We may have already shown it.
Is a thistle a bear?
A thistle. No, a thistle is a plant.
Oh, a thistle.
And we're at about 10,000 feet, the highest part of the Mount Washburn area in Yellowstone, which is the part most known for grizzly bears.
Very cold.
My wife, the photographer, was by the side of the road with the road to her back, bent over, taking a picture of a thistle. That thistle right there, with the bug on it. And that is the actual picture that she took when she did it.
Right.
And she heard the sound like little pebbles on stone, and didn't know what that sound was. She stood up and turned around, and coming down the hillside on the other side was a 900-pound grizzly bear with two cubs, okay? And Sue went, "Rrr!" And the grizzly bear leaned back on its haunches and went, "Rrr!" And Sue very slowly turned around and walked away and stopped about 10 feet away when she realized the bear wasn't going to eat her. But she didn't take a breath for about 4.5 minutes. And by the time she got back to me, she was like, did you see that? Did you see that? Yeah, I said, yes, dear, I saw that. I got that on video. And she's like, oh, okay. And we happen to have a ranger with us.
Oh, and we're going to see that?
Well, no, we're not going to see that.
Oh, we're not.
Because the ranger said nasty words. Okay, and they're not supposed to do that. That's against ranger code. And he made me promise not to play that video ever when he went, what the? And I won't use whatever kind of language he used. But he was right startled that my wife was less than 10 feet away from this 900-pound grizzly bear.
Very lucky.
They're taught not to let people do that. You know, they're kind of funny like that,
right.
You know. With Yellowstone and whatnot, you're told to be very, very careful not to go near the animals. You're taught not to tease them. You're taught not to feed them. And you're taught not to get complacent around them. Because if you get complacent, you're going to get what's coming to you. Because they're still wild animals. No matter what you do, they are wild animals. And one wrong turn, et cetera, and you're going to be in a world of hurt because they're going to remind you that they're wild animals.
Were you worried that your wife was going to get... Well, I
wasn't really worried so much because it was an instant kind of thing. When she turned around to back away from the bear, she went, "Dear." And I hear that. I mean, it's like you hear your own wife, you hear your kids yelling mom and dad, and you can separate it from a crowd. And I turned my head a little bit to look, and because I'm a video guy and have been a video guy for years, there's the picture. When she turned back around, the bear was at that point 15 feet away from her, and right underneath the bear's belly is one of the two cubs.
Oh.
And I wish you could see it on the TV. It's a little too small.
Oh,
but the cub
cute.
Is actually sticking its tongue out at you. So it was like, ha, my mummy's bigger than you are, okay? And then the two of them walked off the side of the road. And just very cool. I mean, just very nicely done and, you know, very sweet. Not a problem. The mama bear didn't have a problem. Sue didn't have a problem. There were no problems there.
Because Sue, you said, did not look at the bear. Sue had her head down.
Right, you're taught.
And that's submissive.
You're taught in Yellowstone land to be submissive with grizzly bears and to be loud and obnoxious with brown bears. If you come across a grizzly bear and you're face to face with a grizzly, you put your eyes down, put your hands to your side, do not look in any way threatening, slowly turn and walk away from the grizzly bear. The grizzly bear is the boss.
How do I know what the difference is between a grizzly bear and a brown
Grizzlies
bear?
Grizzlies are gray with silver cups and silver trim.
Okay,
Brown bears are brown bears. Now, brown bear, you walk up and, you know, if I was this far from a brown bear, what they say to do, I'm not so sure I'd be smart enough to do it, but what they say is you get in the bear's face, you jump up and down, you yell, hey bear, hey bear, hey bear. If you have pots in your hands, you slam the pots together, and the brown bears are generally scared, and they go and they go running away. There's my wife about 3 feet away from the bear.
I would have no problem.
And she was like, I think I'm leaving now.
Look at that.
And you can see the bear going down the side of the hill, and the cubs are cavorting along after it.
Oh, look at that.
Again, she's at best 9 or 10 feet away from a 900-pound grizzly is not a real good idea.
Right.
I don't suggest
that. Look at them. They're cute.
Not part of the regular tourist attraction that is Yellowstone. You know, not a good idea. Those two cubs now will be yearlings this year. They can have cubs every year. When we're going back again this year, we intend to see if we can't look them up because they will be nearly full bear sized, somewhere in the 300 to 350-pound range by this summer. And hopefully one or two of them will still be with mama so we can spot them. We know where they are. We know the area there around Mount Washburn. Yeah.
This is a great story.
It's kind of fun.
So I guess you're going to tell us about the ecosystem, but when we come back.
I think we're going to have to do that when we come back.
Yeah.
I think we're pretty close to our next clip here. I don't know exactly where we are, but the ecosystem in Yellowstone, really quickly, it's built on a caldera.
Okay, so
we're not done.
Okay. So, Bill, you own New England Media Professionals.
That's true.
And if I'm correct, you sold this HD video to a network television, which is fantastic.
Yep. We don't know exactly when this one's going to be on yet. This is my second one. This one will be sometime in the fall for fall sweeps. And this is the next video. Let's take a look at that now.
Okay. Thank you. Bill, that was fantastic.
Wasn't that cool? Look at the geyser there.
I know. Yeah. It's wow. I understand there's a geothermal pot of Yellowstone.
Actually, yeah, that's true. And as you see in the geysers and whatnot coming up behind me here, all of Yellowstone is nothing more than an area of a formerly collapsed volcano. Underneath the ground, well, first of all, you have your regular dirt like you have everywhere else, but way under the ground there, you have lava, a huge pool of lava.
Is the ground hot?
The ground way down is hot, but more importantly, the groundwater that goes over that gets very hot, and because it gets very hot, overboiling, as a matter of fact, it causes what you see here, and all the hot springs aren't the kind of hot springs you as Mr. or Mrs. Tourist want to go sticking your feet into, because that's boiling water. Not a good idea. You can actually see it boiling up right now, right out of the ground.
But when you're walking on the ground, do your feet get hot?
Well, they could if you had bare feet on. You really don't notice it with sneakers or hiking boots
on. I see, okay.
But yes, the ground is very near to hot. They say that Yellowstone has erupted in the past and exploded every 600,000 years, roughly. And lucky us, it's been over 600,000 years since it did it, so it's due again.
So is that what you're saying, that this could erupt at any point in time?
That's what they say. The United States Geological Survey, the University of Utah, and the University of Montana all maintain earthquake monitoring stations in and around the Yellowstone area. There are hundreds of earthquakes every year in Yellowstone, most of them just little tremblers, but
sure,
an occasional three or four on the Richter scale, mainly around the Fishing Bridge area, if you look at a map of Yellowstone. And to the point where they have enough sensors set up, they have enough scientists keeping an eye on it. That, of course, is Old Faithful, the most famous of all the geysers in the park.
So this is where that name came from, Old Faithful.
Right, it goes off every 90 minutes like clockwork. It's not the biggest geyser in the park, but again, because of the geothermal activity, the water settles back down, it reheats, it boils in 90 minutes, it explodes back up again, about 170, 175 feet. A major tourist attraction. If you see one thing while you're in Yellowstone, see that. Of course, there are eagles there. There are all kinds of animals. There's nothing, I mean, there's no place in the world you can go and see a wild assortment of wild animals like you can there. When you get there in the early spring, that is a marmot who was defending her mate. That's a mama marmot. Well, maybe a foot and a half tall.
Because it looks giant.
There's her and Papa right there. They're about 2 feet long. They're like giant groundhogs, basically. That's a raven, okay. But anyway, in the early spring, they haven't been annoyed by people all winter long. They've had the park to themselves. So when you get there at the end of May, beginning of June, the bears and whatnot are wandering all over the place because it's their territory.
And they think that you're one of them.
Well, they don't know what you are. Many times, if you stop and look at something, it will turn up and look at you because it doesn't know what to make of you.
Do you allow them to come up to you and sniff you?
Heck no. That's why you have car doors. You get in, you run back up the trail into the car and close the door because usually, you know, grizzly bear and whatnot. Grizzly's not that much of a problem. You know where the grizzlies usually are. And most of the other animals are more afraid of you than you are of them ever.
So do they come up to the car?
But they coexist very nicely. Oh, they're perfectly welcome to walk right in front of you, walk by you, give you a sidelong glance as they go. As long as you don't bother them, they won't usually bother you. But
right,
not a real good idea to, like, take a peanut butter jelly sandwich and offer it to, like, a bear or anything. Probably not a real good idea at all.
So I have a question. What was your favorite part? What was your favorite part of going to Yellowstone on this last trip?
No people.
Oh, because you said something that was very important before we came on the air.
What was that?
You were saying that you go out there because it's almost like a spiritual retreat for you. It's a place
for
where
me.
You,
it is. Yeah.
Where you find your inner.
Everybody has something they do that makes them feel grounded. And I don't care how anybody wants to do it. To everybody, to each their own.
Sure.
Some people go to church every Sunday. Some people pray out of a good book.
Yellowstone is your church.
Yellowstone is where I go to reconnect with Mother Nature and to put my feet on the ground and know everything's okay and everything's the way it should be. And it's been like this for millions of years. And you know what? It'll probably be like this millions of years from now.
This is why you're such a grounded human being.
And the buffalo are coming back and thrive in droves.
Great.
We're out of time right now. We're going to take a look at another piece. We'll talk about Yellowstone fires.
Ooh, wow, that's exciting.
Back.
Yeah.
Bill.
Hi. I was watching my own video.
I know. So tell us about the Yellowstone fires.
Fires. Yep. If you see the screen right now, back in 1988, there was the last of the huge Yellowstone fires. Thousands and thousands of acres burned, and the park officials were all concerned. The states around them were all concerned. They were spending millions of dollars of manpower just to keep the fires under control and try to fight them. It's a lost cause. I mean, when a wildfire rips across the plain out there, there's no way you're stopping it. But the neat thing is, here it is less than 5 or 10 years after the last series of fires, not 88, but the last series. And as you can see in the video, the lower part of the video, I don't know if you can see it on the screen or not, but anyway, it's all coming back, and the animals all came back. The park officials now are not worried about it because Yellowstone will survive and will come back no matter what.
Absolutely.
And we're out of time. Jojo, thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Go visit Yellowstone if you can, everybody. It's a great time. You'll have a good time, and thank you for letting
me
come on and be on Yellowstone.
Yeah. Yeah.
This world.